Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
National Interest this week explores what I see as a very major consequence of these elections, because it pertains not just to immediate politics but has consequences that may last another generation. Why? Because this election has ended an epoch in Indian politics. It's a 30-year epoch, because in 1989, leaders in India, or rival leaders in India, founded Mandal and Mandir politics. And for 30 years, that equation, Mandal versus Mandir, determined political destinies in India. Let me try and explain to you very briefly. Around 1989, when Rajiv Gandhi was weakening, Mr. Advani, who was the BJP's foremost strategist at that point, he was looking for a way to push Rajiv Gandhi out of power. Remember, in 1984, Rajiv had reduced BJP to just 2 seats. That issue, because he knew Rajiv was weak, but he needed a story. He found the story in the temple issue in Ayodhya. Until then, that issue had been quite dormant. He found that issue. He was building it, and Rajiv responded to it by allowing the Shilanyas and starting his 1989 campaign from there. But he combined with VP Singh, who had rebelled from Rajiv's cabinet to challenge him, and who looked the most likely candidate to replace Rajiv if he lost power. So sure enough, Rajiv lost power. VP Singh was chosen the head of the new government. But his party, the Janata Dal, had only 143 seats, way short of the 272. So a national front was set up with many coalition partners, and yet they were short of numbers. So the left and the BJP decided to support that coalition from outside without joining it to keep Rajiv Gandhi out of power. But you knew from day one that there were major contradictions there, because VP Singh's government or the Janata Dal or the national front mainly consisted of people who disliked the BJP and who disagreed with the RSS ideology. There was even a background to it, going back to 1977 when the Janata government came, and ultimately it split over the question of former Jan Sangh members' dual membership, that is RSS and Janata Party. So contradictions were evident. They got worse over that government's handling of the new troubles in Kashmir. So it was a matter of time. Everybody knew when the BJP would pull out support from the VP Singh government. So VP Singh responded to it by building his own politics, what we call the Mandal politics. So he pulled out this old Mandal Commission report, which recommended reservation for other backward castes in addition to the 22.5% reservation already given to scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. He implemented it in a jiffy. Upper castes erupted in anger. Students were burning themselves. I hope you have not forgotten that 159 students tried to burn themselves, upper caste students. Very unfortunately, 63 even succeeded in doing that. It was in that commotion that the BJP withdrew support to that government, and BJP and VP's forces around VP Singh then became adversaries sort of forever. So for those forces, they included then Mulayam Singh Yadav, Lalu Yadav and many others. For them, the main agenda was Mandal, that is empowerment of other backward castes. So they became Mandalite forces. The BJP was a Mandir force. Now, what was the tussle? The tussle was, can you use religion to invite what caste divided? Because Hindu vote banks had now been divided by caste. You had upper castes generally with the BJP, but also here and there. You had OBCs, which you used to either come to the Congress party or were coveted by the BJP as Hindus go to these parties. So that made it impossible for BJP to have a majority of its own, because it was seen as a party that was anti-Mandal and that sympathized with the upper castes. That has continued since then. So for these three decades, these Mandalite forces with Congress and the left, even while fighting them, has acted in concert to keep BJP out of power for two decades out of these three. Remember, that's how someone like Devegowda could become Prime Minister with almost no support of his own, because Congress was willing to support him from outside, just as the left and the BJP had done earlier with VP Singh. That has now broken. And why has it broken? Because this election has shown you that these Mandalite forces have been devastated. Even when they combined, as in UP, and tried to get their vote banks together, it hasn't worked. It only means, one, that their vote banks have broken, but also that their vote banks have become limited in the course of time, because these Mandalite forces then became family-owned enterprises and ultimately got confined to their own castes. So, Samajwadi Party, for example, in UP, does not own all the OBC vote, only the Yadav vote. Mayawati does not own all the Dalit vote anymore, she owns the Jatav vote. And that is where BJP has now moved in. Narendra Modi, what helps is the fact that he is an OBC, also that he has a larger nationalist Hindu appeal. He has a very solid upper caste Hindu vote bank, and he's reached out to these voters and he has breached them quite comprehensively. That's why I am saying now that the Mandal-Mandir epoch, political epoch, is over. A new epoch has begun. Let's call it the Modi epoch. He can today, he has the luxury to reach out to more OBCs, to Dalits, to do more for them. He also has the luxury to reach out to the Muslims, because Hindus already feel empowered under him. I'm not sure how many Muslims will shift, but even if a few shift, it's a big plus for him and a big minus for the rest. But basically, he can tell the Muslims and the OBCs and the Dalits that, look, the time when you could all combine your forces to somehow deny the BJP power or get power for yourselves is now over. So find a different formula. Does it mean that politics has now ended? Politics never ends. So this will be challenged in the course of time, maybe not this week, maybe not next month, but in the course of time, this will be challenged, and we have to look at who can challenge it, and then we draw some conclusions by going one level below the surface in these election results. If you look at the seat numbers, it looks like Congress is obviously almost one-sixth of the BJP. But if you look at the vote numbers, BJP is upward of 22 crores, Congress is upward of 12 crores. So even with 50-odd seats, it has 12 crore votes. So what it tells you is, again, if you compare with 2014, that more and more of these votes, which were maybe with caste-based parties or smaller regional parties, are now moving towards the larger national parties, and new politics is beginning. That's why we are saying that you might, or we might laugh at the Congress or take it lightly, but Modi and Shah won't, because with 12.5 crore votes, that party will always have the capability of threatening this Narendra Modi in this new politics of the Modi epoch.